Alzheimer's disease is the most common form of dementia, with someone developing dementia every 3 seconds, 55 million people currently suffering, and an expected 140 million people expected to be suffering from dementia in the year 2050. But what can we do to prevent ourselves from getting Alzheimer's disease? Hello everybody and welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, my name is Kyle and I have a master's in neuroscience, and I do plan on continuing my studies with relation to neurodegeneration and dementia. One of my biggest hobbies is language learning, ergo why I made this channel, but today I'm going to dive into the research with you all and discuss the question, does learning another language prevent Alzheimer's disease? Before we start, I think it is important to clarify that although Alzheimer's disease is the most common form of dementia, it is not the only type. Thus, the research I'll be presenting today only pertains to Alzheimer's disease and should not be generalized to all the other forms of dementia. Secondly, there are various factors that come into play when assessing someone's risk for developing Alzheimer's disease, such as genetic variants. I'm sure a lot of you have already heard about the different APOE genotypes. Your physical activity and cardiovascular health are also very important. And what we will focus on today, education and neuronal activity or health. A phrase that my grandfather used to always say to me was, if you don't use it, you lose it. And in the case of languages, this is the case. If you have ever learned a language before or attempted to learn a language before, but then left it alone for ages, odds are there's a high chance that you forgot a lot of what you had originally learned. But what if you didn't stop? What if you're now bilingual? Does this have any benefit with regards to preventing Alzheimer's disease? Daniela Perani and others in 2017 published a paper called The Impact of Bilingualism on Brain Reserve and Metabolic Connectivity in Alzheimer's Dementia. They found in this paper that bilinguals have reduced metabolic demand in certain brain regions, or rather they have areas of hypometabolism, i.e. their brain in these areas uses less energy. But contradictingly, these same bilinguals scored better on memory tasks and attention tasks. So the authors in this paper proposed that bilinguals thus use energy more effectively in the brain than monolinguals. Almost more importantly, they found that bilinguals have a stronger, more developed neural connectivity, specifically the executive control network, which is responsible for decision making, problem solving, and working memory. So what does this actually mean? The brains of bilinguals are more robust in their connectivity and their energy efficiency. But that's not the end of the story. With this, I want to introduce a new term called cognitive reserve. Cognition is essentially your brain power, and then reserve is having something spare. And this is how we're going to be tying in all of this science talk with Alzheimer's dementia. Neural activity and training through the act of bilingualism develops two aspects of cognitive reserve: neural reserve and neural compensation. In the case of the bilinguals, this neural reserve refers to an increased density of gray and white matter in the brain, specifically in those areas with networks focusing on executive function and language learning. And then there's also neural compensation, where the brain is more resilient to neuronal loss, where other areas of the brain or the networks are able to take up the responsibilities of the damaged neurons or the damaged brain cells, particularly important in a neurodegenerative disease. In brief summary so far, bilingual brains have more gray and white matter networks, and their brains are more resilient when neurons die. Does this in essence mean that you're immune to Alzheimer's disease if you're bilingual? Unfortunately, no. However, it does mean that your brain ages better and is healthier for longer. Bilinguals typically, on average, develop Alzheimer's dementia symptoms 5 years later than monolinguals. So it can push out and prevent Alzheimer's in this regard, but there are quite inconclusive data when it comes to whether or not language learning itself can lower the incidence or lower the risk of developing Alzheimer's disease. But to give you some more good news, it is worth mentioning the other risk factors associated with developing Alzheimer's disease, namely cardiovascular health and what's called social network and social engagement. The participants used in these studies, quite logically, are all over the age of 70 years old. In this age group, the importance of cardiovascular health was not as enforced as they were growing up, and smoking was a lot more common. In our generation, and the ones that came before and the ones that will come after, the importance to stay fit and healthy is much more widespread. And as long as you adhere to the advice, your risk of developing Alzheimer's disease shrinks or reduces as well. The ability to use your languages has never been easier with the internet and how multicultural the world has become. So making new friends and expanding your social network has never been more accessible. So I want you to keep in mind that if you learn a language and you use it, you stay fit and healthy, these extra 5 years of symptom-free life, compounded with a better healthcare, better cardiovascular health and better education than in the 1950s, might just mean that you never experienced Alzheimer's disease in your lifetime. I have one more important note to mention at the end of this video, but for right now, I want to thank you all for watching, and if you enjoyed it, leave a like, comment, and subscribe if you also like my other videos, because they're not all like this, but I'm gonna try and make more. But that's everything for now, thanks so much, and see you next time. I just wanted to briefly say before we end this video that these studies talked about lifelong bilingualism and not specifically learning a language as an adult or when you're older. More research on this topic is getting a lot of traction, and preliminary studies suggest similar findings with regards to neural connectivity. Thus, one can speculate that everything said in this video also applies to when you learn a language later in life and become bilingual. However, this should be held in mind as a limitation of all of these studies.